In the year 65 BC, the Roman armies under General Pompey captured Jerusalem. In 70 AD, General Vespasian and his son Titus put an end to the Jewish state with great slaughter. During the period of the military governors of Palestine, many outrages and atrocities were committed against the residue of the people. During the period from Pompey to Julius, it has been estimated that over 1 million Jews fled into Africa, fleeing from Roman persecution and slavery. The slave markets were full of black Jewish slaves. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people, from the one end of the earth even to the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 64. This prophecy and all the residue of the prophecy contained in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 15 to 68 befell the black Jews after they disobeyed the laws of God. Many nations transported the Jews into slavery, and the sons of Israel transmigrated to every continent. The Jewish philosopher Philo, about 40 BC to 40 AD, who lived in Alexandria, Egypt, said that 1 million Jews resided in Libya and Egypt, from the Katabatmos to the borders of Ethiopia. Professor A.H. Godbe says that Philo leaves us doubtful about which boundaries of Ethiopia he meant. I think that Philo meant the western southern boundaries of Ethiopia, because the prophet Zephaniah mentioned from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, the daughters of my dispersed, quote, end quote. There was a period of over 600 years between Zephaniah and Philo, and considering the new waves of immigrants coming into Africa, they had 600 years to penetrate towards all the borders of Ethiopia. E. Skewer wrote that Hebrewism was detectable by its inscriptions from the Egyptian border westward across North Africa to Mauritania. A. H. Godbe says Jerome, 340 to 420 AD, one of the four doctors of the church, wrote that the Jews were spread from the western extremity of Mauritania to India. Now, ancient Mauritania included part of the territory on the Atlantic Ocean, Morocco, and part of modern Algeria. It is certain that the Jews had migrated all across North Africa by the 2nd century. Some scholars fix the date earlier than this. The Greek historian and geographer Strabo, 63 BC, 24 AD, said concerning the Jews of Cyrene, Libya, "Now these Jews already have gotten into all cities, and it is hard to find a place in the habitable earth that has not admitted this tribe of men and is not possessed by it. And it has come to pass that Egypt and Cyrene, as having the same governors, and a great many of other nations, imitate their way of living, maintain great bodies of these Jews in a peculiar manner, privileged status, and grow up to greater prosperity with them, and make use of the same laws which with that nation also. After the fall of the Carthaginian metropolis in North Africa, Roman power became dominant in the Barbary states under Roman suzerainty, could be sovereignty and power. The Jews of Asia and North Africa rebelled AD 115. The Jews considered themselves numerous enough to challenge Roman authority in the East and the South because of their numbers. The Jews almost subdued their adversaries, who had compelled them to suffer many atrocities and indignities. Emperor Trajan sent his general Turbo to bring law and order. Instead of bringing law and order, the act of suppression of the insurrection brought a massacre. The suppression of the rebellion under the slogan of law and order may be good in principle, but a good thing may be carried too far. So it was in this case. The pagans and the Romans attacked the Jews indiscriminately. Both the Jewish soldier and the uninvolved peaceful population without mercy. As a result of this merciless attack, many Jews fled to parts of Northwest Africa known as Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, and Mauritania. Many other Jews fled to the areas where Rome did not have any jurisdiction. This was to the region of the south, the Sahara Desert, and the Sudan. Grazel says, Such is the explanation of how the Sahara Desert first acquired Jewish tribes, toughened by a fighting tradition and possessed of physical characteristics, black, which, it is said, still make them approximate very closely the original Jewish population of Palestine. The Jews are an omnipresent people. They seem to exist everywhere. At the beginning of the 6th century, they are found in Spain before the Mohammedan conquest. Spain is known to the Jews as the classical land of crypto-Judaism because they find Christianity but practiced Jewish ritual in secret. As early as the Roman period, the Jews of Spain had been large in number and influential. Many of them claimed to be descendants of noble Jews in Jerusalem who had been carried into exile by General Titus after the Visigoth, a Germanic tribe, invasion. The situation ameliorated for the Jews because the Visigoths adopted the Aryan form of Christianity and they favored the Jews. However, when they converted to Catholicism, they became zealous like any other neophytes. King Riyakard ascended the throne in 589. This was the beginning of harsh religious enactments against the Jews. When King Sesubut or Sesobot occupied the throne, there was a prevalence of the utmost religious fanaticism. In 616 AD, the big shot came. The king ordered the baptism of all the Jews in his domain under the penalty of expulsion and the loss of all their property. According to Catholic authorities, 90,000 embraced Christianity at this time. This was forced baptism. In the 7th century, the Jews were threatened with the penalty of slavery if they were found practicing Judaism. This cruel policy caused many Jews to flee to the Mediterranean and western coast of Africa. The southernmost point of Spain after you cross the sea leads you to the northern or the western coast of Africa. Throughout the Middle Ages, many European governments expelled their Jews. These black Jews migrated to neighboring countries, Turkey and Africa. The Lord shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies, and thou shalt go out one way against them, and flee seven ways before them, and shall be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 25. The Byzantine emperors in the 5th and 6th centuries persecuted the Jews constantly. Therefore, multitudes of Jews were compelled to migrate into the Sahara Desert to the south. By this time, the Sahara Desert was heavily occupied with black Jews. The Arabs pushed their way out of Arabia in the 7th century. In the year 640 AD, they attacked Egypt and continued across Africa. Then a Jewish queen named Daya Kahena organized an army consisting of Jews and Berbers in order to stop the penetration of the Muslims in North Africa. This queen vanquished the Arabs, and the people of Africa rejoiced in her victory. Years later, the Mohammedans fought the army of this Jewish queen once more, and she was defeated. She was defeated the second time because of the jealousies of different peoples in various tribes. Having become disgusted, her son turned Muslim and participated in the Islamic conquest of Spain in the year 711 AD. The Black Jewish Empire of Ghana. The ancient Black Empire of Ghana was established in the Western Sudan. During the colonial period, the Western Sudan was called French West Africa. The northern boundary of this region is the Sahara Desert. The western and southern border is Lake Chad. Some rivers of this region are the Senegal, the Gambia, the Volta, the Benue, the Logone, and last but not least is the famous Niger River. This river flows from the Guinea Highlands northeast to the famous cities of Timbuktu and Gao. Then it makes a sharp turn and flows southeast towards the city of Benin in Nigeria. In ancient times, the Carthaginians from North Africa penetrated the Sahara Desert and the Western Sudan during the 2nd and 3rd centuries BC. When North and Eastern Africa had amassed over 1 million Jews, these Jews began a continuous migration to the region of the Niger River. According to the researches of Nahum Slotches, the tradition of the Jewish traders in the Sahara stretches back to the biblical times. Slotches continues, and it is not at all surprising to encounter in every part of the desert traces and even survivals of a primitive Judaism which at one time played an important role in the whole region of the Sahara from Senegal to the very borders of Somaliland. As I have mentioned earlier, this region that extends across the entire width of Africa below the Sahara Desert from Senegal to Somaliland is known as the Sudan or Black Africa. Between the second and the third centuries, the Black Jews of Arabia continued migrating across the Red Sea to Ethiopia. The largest exodus of the Jews occurred during the persecution by the Arabs led by Muhammad. He had said on his dying bed that he wanted Islam to be supreme throughout all of Arabia. There was a Jewish tribe called Rehab, which crossed the Red Sea and migrated to the extreme point of the Western Sudan. At the same time that the Jews were migrating westward across the Sudan from Ethiopia, they also migrated southward from Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, and Morocco to the fertile region between the Senegal and the Niger rivers. When the Jews from the north and the east met between these two rivers, they established a confluence of crossroads in West Africa where men could exchange their culture, ideas, and merchandise. These Jewish migrations went on with great frequency about 300 AD, and they continued with the utmost regularity for 1200 years. Joseph J. Williams points out the course of the Jewish migration from northeastern Africa. He writes that the Jews migrated up the Nile, passing Memphis, Elephantine, Khartoum, and then they turned west at Kordofan in central Sudan, in the region of the White Nile. Williams thinks some Jews settled in the country of Shiluk in the southern Sudan and Uganda. He continues by tracing the migration from Kordofan, going west to Darfur, Lake Chad, Kano, and then to the countries of the Niger River. The original habitation of the Songhai people was Ganguia, Kokia, or Kuka. This place was situated in the Dendi country and known as Dendina, lying near the Niger River on the northwestern border of what is now modern state of Nigeria. Many scholars think that the Songhai people came from Egypt or Ethiopia because there exist many Egyptian culture complexes among them. For example, the preparation of the dead body for burial. Za el Yemeni came to Kuka about 300 AD, an ancient abode of the Songhai tribe. He established a line of kings known as the Zaja or the Daya dynasty. This founder of the first Sudanic dynasty in Western Africa was a Black Jew. His name is sometimes written Za'al Ayaman. Joseph J. Williams says that a citizen of Timbuktu named Abderrahman Es-Sadi wrote 1652 in his book Tariqa Es-Sudan, History of the Sudan, that Za'al Ayaman was derived from Za min el Yemen, which means he has come from Yemen. Za el Yemeni came to the Niger country by way of Ouargla in central Algeria. Ouargla was a great trading center of the Black Jews. Dr. Barth and Professor Garbe say that Za, the founder of the first Jewish dynasty, established his capital later at Gao on the eastern upper Niger River. The Arabs, Moors, and the Sudanic writers attribute to the ancient Black African Hebrews the establishment of the first empires, the erection of the first public buildings in the country, the construction of the first canals and irrigation systems, and the institution of a socio-economic regime which still survives in all Saharan communities. By what factors can we explain the emergence of Black Hebrew hegemony and leadership over the indigenous tribes? Question. The answer is simple. The Jews came into the Western Sudan from Northern and Eastern Africa as a result of a chain of commercial and persecutory migrations. The Jews had settled among the most civilized people throughout the ages. They adopted new methods from other people and left their material, educational, and moral imprint among the people with whom they resided. For many centuries, the Hebrews had to employ great physical and psychological initiative. They could not afford to be complacent or apathetic. They were hated, so apathy could mean cultural stagnation or death. The Jews imported into the western part of Africa a superior material, educational, and moral culture soon after 300 AD, and this cultural advancement was not duplicated or exceeded until the ascendancy of the Mohammedan leader Mansa Kankan Musa of Mali in 1312 AD. In the 3rd and 4th centuries AD, the Africans on the west coast did not possess the cultural superiority of the Africans on the north and east coast. The Black Jews had an advantage over the African tribes. They carried their culture, history, laws, and written records with them. This assured them a constant precedent for the development of a higher social organization. Because of the stability of the Black Jewish culture, the Jews were not absorbed into the autochthonous population. In fact, the Jews absorbed some of the native tribes. The Jews made use of every opportunity. They were an industrious and skillful people. In the Jewish Ghanaian states were found kings, princes, governors, generals, secretaries, treasurers, revenue agents, judges, architects, engineers, doctors, historians, language interpreters, mathematicians, jewelers, sculptors, masons, carpenters, painters of art, goldsmiths, leather workers, potters, armorers, saddlers, blacksmiths, agriculturalists, etc. The Black Hebrew kings of Ghana had two titles. One, Kayamaga, master of gold. Two, and Ghana, war chief. Professor Godbe says that 22 Hebrew kings reigned in Ghana before the Hegira in 622 AD, and 44 had reigned by 790. Davidson makes mention of the Tariq el-Fitakh, History of the Researcher, which says that Kumbi had been the capital of the vast country of the Kayamaga, while the Tariq el-Sudan states that Kayamaga had been the name of the first king of this country. It is apparent that all the kings of Ghana were called by the title Kayamaga. And concerning Kumbi, the ancient capital of Ghana, it was located in the southern part of the present country of Mali. During the Middle Ages, the name Ghana was not used to designate the country. The name of this country was Aukar, and Ghana was the title of its kings. Having cognizance of this fact indicates the greatness and splendor of those kings, because after the decline of the Tsa dynasty, men began to call this country after the title of its kings, which is Ghana, and I shall do the same. In the 14th century, a Muslim writer named Ibn Battuta wrote about the women in one of the cities of Ghana. He found the women of Walata surpassing beauty, and he should have known what he was talking about because he had traveled widely. Moreover, he found another fact outstanding. The women were given more respect than the men, and the males did not express any resentment or jealousy. the people did not trace their descent from a paternal head, but from their maternal brother. An individual bequeathed his legacy to his sister's son. The material foundation of the Ghanaian estate was based on the affluence of gold and iron. The use of iron in Africa, especially Ghana, revolutionized the social and military systems. El-Zuhri stated that the Ghanaians fought many wars against their neighbors who did not use iron, but fought with bars of ebony. The Ghanaians could destroy their enemies because they fought with lances and swords. The king's revenue agent levied taxes on imports and exports, and the medium of exchange was gold. Concerning the Kingdom of Ghana, Joseph William writes, "Whatever may be thought of the more or less mythological traditions connected with the earliest Jews in North Africa, it is now practically an established fact that a Jewish nation, Jewish at least in faith and perhaps too in origin, long held sway south of the Sahara." Eldad the Danite. In the 19th century, a black African Hebrew arrived in the city of Kairouan in Algeria. In this city was one of the famous Talmudic schools. The name of this Hebrew was Eldad the Danite. He told a credible story of a Hebrew empire south of the Saharan in the western Sudan. According to Eldad the Danite, the Hebrews in the interior of Africa spoke a Phoenician Hebraic language mixed with Arabic. They had a religion which had come down from Moses and a Hebrew emperor. It was believed that this emperor was named Tlotan or Bolatan. Eldad said that the people of this tribe had fled from the kingdom of Israel after Sennacherib the Assyrian had subdued it, and that other Israelite tribes such as Naphtali, Gad, and Asher were in the land from which he came. He told of the laws of Moses which they followed, the complete series of the scriptures except Esther and Lamentations. He did not speak of the legal works that were produced in Babylon and Palestine after the destruction of the first temple, of which the Algerian Jews had a knowledge. These extraordinary works were the Mishnah and the Talmud. Eldad displayed as evidence some ceremony pertaining to the slaughtering of animals for food. It was written in Hebrew with an Arabic ting, but Eldad claimed that he knew no other language than Hebrew. In regard to Eldad's story, the Gaon, head of the Jews, assured the people that the story was credible. We are grateful for the travels and researches of Nahum Slochezl, who wrote in the early part of the 20th century. He said, "For many years, the author of this book has been gathering material for a history of the Jewish migrations into the Sahara and the Sudan. On one part of his work is already done, the establishing of the authenticity of these migrations. To the writing of the Arabs and the oral traditions of the country, he can now add the archaeological evidence furnished by the ruins of ancient Jewish cities in the Sahara and the Sudan, and the documentary evidence of Hebrew inscriptions like those of Taut, which date from the 13th and 14th centuries. It is now an established fact that Ghana was a black Hebrew state, and at this juncture I shall continue my writings concerning the Za dynasty of Ghana. The 15th Za prince took control of the great city of Gao on the upper Niger, AD 1009. His name was Za Kasi or Kosoi. Up to this time, all the kings of Ghana professed the Hebrew religion. However, in this year, a radical transformation occurred. Za Kasi accepted Islam. Davidson, quoting the Tariq el-Fatak, says that the king of Songhai, Ghana, was persuaded to convert to Islam by merchants of the city of Gao, who already had become wealthy and economically powerful. Much of Ghana's trade was maintained with the Muslims of the north. The North Africans were ardent Mohammedans in their way. The economics and religion were co-partners operating concertedly in the city of Gao. I do not condemn Za Kasi for this conversion to Islam. In fact, I shall justify his actions. The Muslims were dominating Ghana's vital trade links in North Africa and the Sahara, and it was good for Ghana's security to recognize as having a Mohammedan king. Concerning Islam in the Western Sudan, Basil Davison makes the following observation. Islam reaches the markets of the Western Sudan by at least the 9th century, but it makes little initial impact. The rulers of Ghana do not accept Islam as one of their state religions. Only at the beginning of the 11th century are there a few such conversions, the earliest of any importance of which we know being that of the King of Gao, traditionally in 1010 or 1010, followed by that of the King of Kanem, Bornu, in 1086. Davidson says, these are tactical conversions. These kings are Muslims only in name, motivated as much by commercial convenience as by appreciation of the political and religious achievements and teaching of Islam. In spite of the fact that the kings of Ghana professed Islam, many of the inhabitants remained Jews. Al-Bekri, the Muslim writer, wrote about Ghana in 1067. The king of Ghana in his day was Tenkaminen, who came to the throne AD 1062. El-Bekri says that the king of Ghana, Tenkaminen, was the ruler of a great empire, and he was able to organize an army of 200,000 men. In the 11th century, a Mohammedan people from the northwest invaded the city of Oudaghast within the Empire of Ghana. These invaders were called the Almoravides. By the year 1076 AD, Abu Bakr, the leader of the Almoravides, captured the capital of Ghana. However, the Islamic Jewish king was allowed to maintain his throne. Tenkaminen paid tribute to Abu Bakr. At this time, Gao, or Gagho, the capital of Ghana, was separated into two cities. The first one was the residence of the king. This city contains a fortress which was surrounded by a wall. The second city contained 12 mosques in which the Mohammedan merchants could settle or wait until they transacted their business. This description given by El-Bekri leaves us with the impression that the city of the king's residence was probably inhabited mainly by Jews, because there was a great distinction between the king's residence and the residence of the Mohammedans. In the city of Gao, the Islamic religion was influential. Only a Muslim could be king. When a new king ascended the throne, three royal imperial emblems constituting the Quran, a sword, and a ring were received by the king. Ahmed Baba, a native of Songhai, dates the beginning of Islam in Ghana after the year 1010. El-Bekri designates the then reigning king as Kanda. Barth says that he is most probably identical with the Islamic Jewish king Zabayuki, or Bayarkoi, Kaima. Or of Ahmed Baba, the third succeeding king of Zakasi, the Empire of Mali. The Empire of Mali is also called the Milistine Empire. The word Mali is derived from a Mandingo grammatical root meaning free. The rulers and people of the Empire of Mali were black Africans of the Mandingo tribe. This tribe was originally situated in the territory known today as Guinea, Sierra Leone, and northward. On the banks of the Upper Niger, near the present-day Sierra Leone, the Mandingos established their capital at a place called Nyanai. after the breakup of the Ghanaian Empire by invasions from many tribes, Ghana split apart into a number of states, but in the capital of Ghana, Gao, the Hebrew Za kings continued to reign. Many people who were subject to Ghana proclaimed their independence after chaos set in. The most celebrated of these people were the Mandingos. The Mandingos, who established the nucleus of a new empire about the middle of the 13th century, 1240 AD. There are several important factors that we must consider in order to comprehend the rise of Mali. First of all, Mali had received an impetus and significant influence from her predecessor, Ghana, to the north. This influence can be explained in political, economic, and religious ways. The Muslim merchants of the north and the Sahara had their trading centers in the cities of Ghana. The Mandingo traders of Mali traded with the Muslims in those days, and to some extent today, commerce and religion have operated together. The Mandingo merchants recognized the advantages of the rapidly growing, powerful, influential culture and religion of the Muslims in the north. As a result, the Mandingo merchants played a great part in the transportation of Islam to their people. The Mandingos were a successful agricultural people. They were blessed with the availability of rivers, which they used for irrigation. They grew rice and other staples, which contributed to a rapidly growing population. The people of Mali had enough grain to sell to the people of the Sahara and the north. They developed market towns, which later grew into cities and states. With their trading abilities, their skill, and vigorous energy, Davidson said the Mandingos became rich. Davidson continued, with the collapse of Ghana as an empire, their chance of large political power was open. They grasped it with a sure hand. In dealing with the kings of Mali, Ibn Khaldun is rated as our best authority. He wrote about 1376 AD. The king of Mali, who is rendered credit for the establishment and organization of an imperial system in Mali, was Sundiata. The year that the Mandingo state rose to imperial power is dated from 1240. In this year, a decisive battle was fought between the Mandingos and a people from Tekrur, evidently Almoravides from medieval Mauritania. Sundiata defeated Sumanguru and his people, who had captured the seat of the Hebrew kings of Ghana, and imposed a tribute on them. Like other kings of the Western Sudan, Sundiata knew the power was contingent on wealth. Most of the wealth was in trade, and most of the trade was in the hands of Muslims. Consequently, he converted to Islam. Almost 100 years after the death of Sundiata, a powerful king emerged in Mali. His name was Mansa Musa. During his lifetime, 1312-1337, his accomplishments transcended his predecessors. His empire extended from east to west, beginning at the Atlantic Ocean to the northern modern Nigeria, and from north to south, reaching almost from central Mauritania and extending to the borders of modern Guinea and the Ivory Coast. In 1326 AD, Mansa Musa made a pilgrimage to Mecca, the holy city of the Mohammedans. It is said that he exhibited a marvelous splendor that astonished the spectators. He arrived in the east with thousands of foot soldiers and over 60,000 mounted warriors. In addition to his soldiers, he had 500 slaves, each carrying a rod of gold weighing 6 pounds. As a contribution to the holy cities, he gave 20,000 pieces of gold. Mali, in its heyday, was known for its prosperity and peace. Within the empire existed one pervading system of law, order, and justice. An African visitor, Ibn Battuta, had this to say about the Sudan: the inhabitants had a greater abhorrence of injustice than any other people. Neither the man who travels nor he who stays at home has anything to fear from robbers or men of violence. This fact might seem incredible to those people who think that black men are innately violent. During the lifetime of Mansa Musa, commerce increased on a large scale. The merchants of Mali established relay stations throughout the empire at important centers. These enterprises reached the forest country south of Senegal and the Niger rivers. Before the time of Mansa Musa, the city of Timbuktu was founded in the latter part of the 11th century. Barth thinks that it was first a small marketplace for the inhabitants of the province of Rad. Mansa Musa is not only remembered for his pilgrimage, trade, and military accomplishments, but also for his public constructions. The king of Mali built a palace and several mosques in the celebrated city of Timbuktu. At the extremities of the city of Timbuktu, the mosques were erected. The mosque of Djengere Ber was located in the southwest, and the mosque of Sankore was located in the northern quarter of the city. Mansa Musa was indeed a champion of Islamic religion and learning. This was the time that the city of Timbuktu and Djene began to rise as scholastic cities. Concomitant with the mosque of Sankore was established also the University of Sankore. This university, during the period of the dynasty of Askia the Great, acquired a universal reputation as a university of theology, law, philosophy, medicine, history, etc. Before I shall continue, it behooves me to explain to you that the later empire of Songhai was erected on the foundations of the empire of Ghana. The only difference was that Songhai was greater in land area, more Islamic, more scholastic, and it terminated with a native African king. When the emperor Kankan Musa was on his pilgrimage in Arabia, Sagamandir, the general of Mali, took Gao, the capital of Ghana, or Songhai. Then Kankan Musa returned from Arabia by way of Gao and accepted the capitulation of the king of Ghana and its nobles. Philip St. Laurent, who writes a monthly article on African history, see Tuesday magazine, for the Philadelphia Bulletin, says that the soldiers of Mali were made prisoners of the ruling family of Daya Soboi. This was the Zahiru dynasty. Among these prisoners were Ali Colon or Kilium and his brother Selmar Nar, the sons of Yasebi. These Hebrew princes were appointed as pages at the court of Mali about 1335 AD. In the meantime, Gao was subjected under the Mali political system, says Davidson, and the Mansa Kankan Musa exacted tribute from its rulers. It was not too long before the princes of Za dynasty escaped from the court and army of Mali. They organized an army and fought the king of Mali. Ali Colon entertained a profound hatred against the Mali conquerors because they had subjugated his people. In the latter part of the 14th century, the army of Ali Colon, later called Sonai the Liberator Ali, made attacks on Nayanai, the capital of Mali. Yearning for independence, Sani Ali desisted in paying tribute to Mali. Because of the exploits of Sani Ali, the Za dynasty of Gao acquired a new appellation. The dynasty after Sani Ali is called the Sani or Shai dynasty. There were about 17 or 18 Islamic Hebrew kings in this dynasty, the Empire of Songhai. In the year 1464, the 16th Za prince Sani Ali took the leadership of Gao and began to build a new empire. Sani Ali attacked many of the neighboring tribes, including the city of Timbuktu, and brought them under his hegemony. For his strength, he did not depend too much on the Muslims of the cities, but primarily on the inhabitants of the countryside. Sani Ali was not even a good Muslim. He adhered to the traditional religion of Gao and the Songhai people. In almost every way, Songhai was a greater empire than Mali. Sani Ali systematized various schemes of organization and administration unknown by his predecessors. He appointed governors over his territories and organized a standing professional army consisting of an echelon, including a navy on the Niger. The Songhai Empire seems to have begun with Sani Ali first. This was the time of the decline of the Empire of Mali in the year 1350 AD, but the superior vigor of the Songhai Empire did not occur until the time of Askia the Great. Now, pertaining to the temperament of Sani Ali, many writers say that it was uncontrollable. He would put to death many of his important officials and ministers of state, later wishing they were alive. Sani Ali's secretary at this time was a man named El Khadr, for whom Sani Ali had ordered the death penalty because of a contradiction. In the course of time, a book arrived that no one in the king's court could read but El Khadr. Then the king expressed remorse for his rash action. At that juncture, his secretary was brought into his presence. On seeing him, Sani Ali displayed great joy and gave valuable gifts to those who saved him. There were another distinguished officer of the state who survived death in this manner, known by various names such as Mohammed Taure and Abu Bakr, who succeeded Sani Ali as Askia the Great. After Sani Ali had completed his business in Gao, his unconquerable military impulse moved him on. He attacked to the east and the west, expanding the empire. His predatory acts acquired for him much booty, but a change of fortune caused his death. When he was crossing the Kani River, he fell into the torrent and was drowned. The body of the great king was prepared and preserved according to the ancient Egyptian custom. This custom consisted of the extraction of the intestine and the insertion of honey. Sani Baro, sometimes called Abu Kebr, succeeded Sani Ali on the throne, but his reign was very short. After the death of Sani Ali, his most distinguished general, Mohammed Taure, plunged the empire into civil war. Mohammed Taure fought Sani Baro at Danja and defeated him. Then Baro took refuge at Gao, the capital. Mohammed Taure stopped for a while in order to recognize his army before resuming the war. After a prolonged and bloody battle, Sani Baro was conquered and forced into exile. When hearing that Mohammed had seized the kingdom from Baro, the daughters of Sani Ali were said to have exclaimed, "Askia, Askia, usurper. As a result of this, Mohammed immediately decreed that he be called by no other name than Askia, and he became known as Mohammed Askia, the founder of the native African dynasty, the last to exist in this part of the Sudan. With the rise of the Askian dynasty, the Zazuni dynasty of the Black Hebrew Kings was terminated about the year 1492 AD. To perpetuate his illegal rule, Muhammad Askia employed political cunning. He became a zealous Muslim and secured the confirmation of the ecclesiastical authorities. He advocated that Mohammedanism should be spread throughout the empire. Askia discharged a group of soothsayers and surrounded himself with theologians. He consulted with them on many important matters. With Askia's urging, the theologians proclaimed a declaration which said Sani Ali was a heretic and that the struggle against Sani Baru was a holy war. About 3 years after the civil war, Askia emulated Mansa Kankan Musa of Mali by undertaking a long pilgrimage to the holy cities in the east. His cavalcade consisted of a vast number of infantrymen and cavaliers. On this pilgrimage was also a retinue of 1,500 princes and chiefs of the empire. While Askia was in Mecca, he spent 100,000 pieces of gold. This was more than any other ruler had spent. In Mecca, he purchased a garden and set up a charitable institution for the people of the Sudan. He gave to the Caliph of Baghdad gifts that astonished the entire court. These contributions surpassed all other kings. The Caliph of Baghdad, Abbasid Mutawakkil, was immensely impressed with Askia. With the Caliph's consent, Askia was made his deputy in Songhai, and as a sign of his authority, the Caliph gave Askia a green fez and a white turban. In Cairo, Egypt, Askia passed many hours among the religious scholars, forming a special acquaintance with a scholar named Esuyotai. It was here in Cairo that Askia accepted many advanced concepts about political science, which he put into practice in the Sudan. Askia returned to his homeland with an enlarged mind and many new experiences. He appointed his brother Omar commander of the army, and he began to consolidate the expanding empire initiated by Sani Ali. Attacking many tribes, unbelievers in Islam, Askia declared war on the Yoyofs and the Mosi. At first, he sent an ambassador to the king of the Mosi, demanding that the king convert to Islam. The king refused, and Askia displayed no mercy in the war that followed. He decimated the Mosi hamlets and towns, making all the inhabitants prisoners and forced them all to become Muslim. The length of his empire extended from the Atlantic Ocean beyond Lake Chad in the east. After the year 1502, the army of Askia invaded the state of Mali. The Songhais sustained such a large number of fatalities that Omar remarked, "The Songhai will be exterminated." The reply of Askia was, "On the contrary, the conquered nations will make our lives easier, for they will be part of us and will assist us in our enterprises. But Askia is known for more than his conquest," writes Davidson. The literate culture of the Western Sudan, already in existence for several hundred years, flowered in Timbuktu during years that saw in Europe the ravage of the Hundred Year War. No one can say how much it flowered, nor what fruits it bore. For the books that men read or wrote, there are lost or not yet found. But Leo Africanus, two centuries later, gives some measure of the city intellectual life. In Timbuktu, he says, "There are numerous judges, doctors, and clerics, all receiving good salaries from the king. He pays great respect to men of learning. There is a big demand for books in manuscript imported from Barbary. More profit is made from the book trade than from any other line of business." The king, of course, was Askia the Great. Whereas Gao was the political capital of the Songhai Empire, Timbuktu was the cultural capital. Many of the students of Timbuktu, Gao and Genie, were sent to the Muslim universities of North Africa, Spain, and Asia. Also, many learned men, irrespective of nationality, were summoned to stay at the celebrated city of Timbuktu, where money was appropriated for their learning. In order to unite his empire, Askia interlocked the royal families by marriage, says Du Bois the highest officer of the state were either chosen from the royal family or married to its princesses, as were the principal military chiefs, forming a dynasty aristocracy of the greatest importance to national unity. For better administrative organization, Askia set up 4 viceroys in his empire, one in the east around Lake Chad, a second one in the north around Timbuktu and Gao, a third one was in the northwest, and a fourth in the southwest. Because the government of Songhai was strong, Askia was able to control the commerce. He built a merchant fleet and war fleet to facilitate commerce in the harbors and canals that he constructed on the Niger River and its branches. As a result, the economy and commerce developed with a tremendous upsurge. The city of Jinni became a melting pot of eternal commerce, Timbuktu of international commerce. For the first time, the Portuguese established trading companies on the west coast of Africa in the year 1448. During the lifetime of Askia, North African and Portuguese ships sailed to the Songhai port at Kabara, in the center of the Niger. In order to perpetuate and facilitate trade, Askia standardized the system of weighs and measures. There was no toleration of highway robbery. Anybody found culpable of this overt act incurred the utmost punishment. During the reign of Askia I, his son Askia Mausa revolted and expelled his father. Years later, with the help of another son, Ismail, he returned to Gao, the capital. After reigning for 35 years, he died in 1538, despite the fact that there existed much debauchery among Askia's descendants. The strong government he created ensured its survival for many years. Final chaos came to Songhai when the Moors invaded in 1591. The Moors came to acquire wealth. They paid a dire price for their predatory exploits. Some writers have estimated that 23,000 Moors perished in one way or another in the military campaigns against Songhai. After 2 decades, the Moors withdrew their military forces from Songhai in 1618. Basil Davidson has this to say about Songhai: "But if their invasion cost the Moroccans much more than it was worth, it cost Songhai its place in history, for it demolished the unity and administrative organization of the state, and while it left Timbuktu and Gao and Djenne as considerable cities, it robbed this civilization of its vitality." From that moment, says the chronicle, the Tarikh, everything changed. Danger took the place of security, poverty of wealth. Peace gave way to distress, disasters, and violence. After the Moors withdrew from the Sudan, the Portuguese, French, and English established colonies and seized the mineral resources of these countries. The final dispersion of the Black Jews of Africa, early North America. Early North Africa. Many scholars call the inhabitants of North Africa Berbers, but I shall not do so. I do not like this word Berber. First of all, it is not a native word of Africa, therefore it is misleading. The Greeks and Romans called the people of North Africa Berbers, which means barbarians. However, the people of this region have their own names. The unbiased Greek historian Herodotus, may honor be given to him, gives the original names of the tribes of North Africa, beginning from Egypt, extending to the Atlantic Ocean. They are as follows: Adramakiadai, Gilligamai, Asbitai, Asbitai, Aushisai, Kabalians, Nasamonians, Numidians, Silai, Garamantians, Makai, Gindanis or Gindanes, Lalofagi, Lalofagi, Maclians, Ausaeans, Ausaeans, Trollodites, Zavacians, Gyzanians, Gyzantians, Atarantians, and Atlantis. Atlantis. Yeah. Herodotus says there are four nations in Africa. Two are indigenous, Ethiopians and Libyans. The Phoenicians and Greeks are newcomers. Herodotus considered all the North African tribes to be Libyans and all the African below the Sahara to be called Ethiopians. These are his two indigenous nations in Africa. The original inhabitants of North Africa were Hamites. These Hamites were black like the Egyptians, and this point has been proven by Herodotus. Because most of the history in the Western world has been distorted, it becomes necessary for me to explain to you some of these distortions, says Heinrich Barth, a European writer. The inhabitants of Walata are a mixed race of blacks and whites. Now, the question is, whom does he include as his whites? Continues Barth. The whites are Berbers and Arabs. These Berbers and Arabs were not whites in ancient times. What is his basis for calling them whites? The obvious reason is that he wants to attribute ancient advanced civilization to the white race in order to perpetuate the philosophy of white supremacy. Many black people have straight noses and thin lips. The black people that possess these qualities are said to have a white morphology form. Joseph Williams has this to say about the blacks of West Africa. In most mixed groups of Negroes, a Sanghois may be identified at first glance. His skin is black as theirs, certainly, but nothing in his mask conforms to their well-known characteristics. The nose of the Sanghois is straight and long, pointed rather than flat. The lips are comparatively thin, and the mouth wide rather than prominent and broad, while the eyes are deeply set and straight in their orbits. A cursory glance shows that the profile resembles that of the European. Some European writers even penetrate into the blackest Africa and divide the blacks according to the shape of their nose and lips. Continues Williams, the Songhais, though black-skinned and woolly-haired, their features are often of Caucasian cast. There are many colored people in the United States with straight noses and thin lips, even as black as tar. And the Europeans do not classify these colored people as belonging to the white race. After extensive research, my conclusion is this. Some European writers have classified certain tribes in Africa and Asia as belonging to the white race. They do this as long as it is psychologically advantageous, in order to inflate their ego and to give them a prominent place in Afro-Asian history. Not only were the people of Africa and Asia black in ancient times, but also the European lands of the Mediterranean, the Canaanites and the Phoenicians in Africa. The language, which is called Hebrew Phoenician or Canaanite, was employed in the lands called Phoenicia, Palestine, or Canaan, Canaan, for over 1,000 years before the Aramaeans, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob came to Canaan or Canaan. The Israelites lost their Aramaic language and adopted the Hebrew speech of the Canaanites. The Hebrew Phoenician merchants from the cities of Sidon and Tyre controlled the trade along the Mediterranean coast for more than 1,000 years before there were any economic treaties made with the Israelites. The Hebrew-speaking Phoenicians, Canaanites, established their great city, Carthage, at Tunis in North Africa. All the Canaanites were black people.
Before the Phoenicians established their colony, Carthage in Africa, many Hebrew-speaking Canaanites had migrated across northern Africa. One Tosefta, quoting an elder source, says that when Joshua approached Canaan, he told the inhabitants that three courses were open to them. They could either leave the country, or they could sue for peace, or they could declare war against him. The Girgashites, among others, preferred to withdraw into Africa. The Tosefta goes on to say that the Amorites, the Kadmoni, the Kenites, and the Kenizzites, some of whom figure among the founders of Carthage, also went to Africa. These traditions date from a period when communication between Africa and Phoenicia was continuous. The proper names of Girgash and Kenaz are often met within Carthaginian and Phoenician inscriptions. The Talmud says that the Canaanites in Africa asked Alexander the Great to restore to them their country, which had been taken from their ancestors by Joshua ben Nun. These traditions have been ratified by the fathers of the church. Thus, Saint Jerome calls to witness the Talmud to support his statement that the Girgashites established colonies in Africa, and Saint Augustine designates the natives of Africa as Canaanites. The prophet Isaiah chapter 19 verse 18 says that five cities in Africa will speak the language of Canaan. We should not forget that the Israelites have been engaged in commercial enterprises, activities, and migrations since Solomon's treaty with the Phoenicians. The Phoenicians established their metropolis, Carthage, in the 9th century BC. Eventually, they conquered the neighboring tribes from Libya to the Atlantic, disseminating their Hebrew-Phoenician language and culture in every direction. The Hebrew-Phoenician language and culture were invigorated and strengthened by the deportation and the migration of energetic black Hebrews from Palestine. Ptolemy Soter of Egypt conquered Syria and Phoenicia, deporting more than 100,000 Hebrews. The Persian king Cambyses had previously sanctioned the colonization of Hebrews in Egypt. During the wars of Maccabees, thousands of Hebrews became slaves and exiles. Ptolemy Lathyrus captured 10,000 slaves from the region of the Sea of Galilee. The kings of Egypt, Psammitic first and Psammitic second, used Israelite garrisons on the Egyptian borders near Libya. The wars with Rome compelled hundreds of thousands more to escape into North Africa. During the Punic Wars and after, North Africa contained a large Hebrew population. This Hebrew population made converts and intermarried with the Canaanites and the native Africans. The city and language of Hannibal. At the ruins of Carthage, archaeologists have found about 4,000 inscriptions in the ancient language of Canaan. Nahum Sloches says these inscriptions date from the time of Nehemiah, of Simon the Just, of Hannibal, and of Hasdrubal, says Sloches. And most valuable of all, we have found again the ancient language and writing of Canaan, the rich idiomatic speech of a city which once counted 700,000 inhabitants, and we Hebrew writers, we who write and feel in our biblical tongue, have recognized at once that this recalled Phoenician language is nothing more less than Hebrew, a pure Hebrew dialect, nearly the same as was spoken in the country of Israel. The population of Carthage was derived from Palestine, and its civilization was Hebraic in origin. Sloches is certain, after much research, that the language Hannibal spoke and in which he directed his troops was Hebrew. There is evidence that the Carthaginians possessed a high priesthood, and their ceremonies and sacrifices were similar to the rituals found in the Book of Leviticus. According to some inscriptions, the Hebrew tribes of Asher and Zebulun were in Carthage from the foundation of the city. At the ruins of Carthage were excavated mainly inscriptions containing many Hebrew names such as Joab, Joaz, and Joel. The city of Tunis is said to be neither Arab nor European. Tunis is a Jewish city. Nowhere else does the Jew feel at home as he does in Tunis, Sloches says so beautifully. And indeed, Tunis, the interior of Hebrew Carthage, is the eternal city of the Jews. For like the phoenix, the Jews have risen again and again out of the ashes of their destruction. After the sacking of Carthage, the Jews were found again in Carthage under Roman domination. After the Byzantine persecutions, they fled into the desert. And even under the persecution of the Arabs, the Jews somehow managed to survive catastrophe after catastrophe.
The Moorish Empire. In less than 100 years, the Black Arabs had pushed their way completely across North Africa in the 7th century. At this time, the Arabs were black. They had not mixed much with other people. The Arabs did penetrate into the interior of the Sahara Desert, but only in small numbers so that the territory remained basically African. Muley Idris, the descendant of Ali, the son-in-law of Mohammed, brought northern Morocco under his control late in the 7th century. His son and successor was Idris II, who founded the Kingdom of Fez. At this time, in the land of Spain, the black Jews were persecuted and many had fled to Morocco for refuge. As a result of this persecution, the Jews of Morocco and the Moors planned to invade Spain with the assistance of Spanish Jews. In the meantime, the plot was uncovered and the Jews of Spain suffered for their intentions. Early in the 8th century, the Mohammedans from Morocco united with the black Jews, made what we call an amphibious landing at Gibraltar. This invasion was successful. Nahum Sloches says that the first one to set foot on the soil of Spain was General Tarif, a Jew of the tribe of Simeon, after whom the island of Tarifa opposite Tangiers was named. However, the Rock of Gibraltar, previously known as the Pillars of Hercules, received its new name from the great Moorish conqueror Gebel el Tariq, which means the Mountain of Tariq. Here is a vivid account of the conquering Moors described by a writer who sympathized with Christian Spain. The reins of their horses were as fire, their faces black as pitch, their eyes shone like burning candles, their horses were swift as leopards, and the riders fiercer than a wolf in the sheep fold at night. The noble Goths were broken in an hour, quicker than tongue can tell. O luckless Spain! These black Moors ruled over parts of Spain for more than 700 years. During this time, the Moors developed the greatest cultural civilization known anywhere in Europe. In the last half of the 11th century, there emerged a powerful dynasty of sultans from Senegal, West Africa, known as the Almoravides. They established their capital at Marrakesh, Morocco, and became masters of a new empire that included Senegal, Morocco, Algeria, Tunis, and southern Spain. This empire was even larger than Western Europe. At this time, the first general of the Senegalese was Abu Bekr, who was supplanted by a stronger general, Yusuf Ben Takfin. Yusuf's first aim was to construct an elegant capital with marvelous houses, a marble-floored palace, and beautiful flower beds. The city that he built, Marrakesh, or Morocco City, became the name of this country. When Moorish power was declining in Spain, Yusuf crossed the Mediterranean into Spain in order to reinforce Moorish control. He brought 15,000 black troops with him and defeated Alfonso the sixth with his 70,000 Christians at the Battle of Zalaca. During the wars of the Almoravides, the greatest commander and hero of Spanish literature, was slain. His name was Rodrigo Díaz de Vivar, better known as El Cid. The Moors were known for more than just conquest. While the remaining part of Europe was in a state of ignorance, the Spanish people took advantage of the knowledge of the Black Moors during the Moorish rule. Many other capitals of Europe were mere hamlets, but Cordova, the capital of Spain, was a booming city. It is said that after dark, one could walk many miles in Cordova and never pass through a street not lighted by public lights. When a person walked out after dark in London, he had to carry a candle or lantern with him to illuminate his path, and had to wear high shoes to walk through the thick mud that often covered the roads. When many Europeans were garbed in skins and in coarse garments, the Moors were wearing silks, linens, and cotton cloth. They also washed in 900 bath houses of Cordova. The palace of the Moorish Sultan or Caliph was far greater in beauty, comfort, and wealth than any of the castles of the medieval kings. The Moors used extremely highly polished marble in their construction. The sides of the walls were patiently carved, and the floors were made with various decorations called mosaics. It is said that the Moors were masters in mosaic work. The Arabs and Moors were known not only for their handicraft, but also for their science. Most of the knowledge of ancient Greece and the Near East was unknown in Europe during the medieval period. The Arabs had come into close relationship with Greek and Persian culture. The Arabs did not destroy this culture. Instead, they brought it to North Africa. There were many famous Moorish and Hebrew scholars in southern Spain. The Black Jews, like the Arabs and Moors, made a great contribution not only to Afro-Asian civilization, but also to the European. The Jews in the East knew Greek and Syriac. They helped translate the works of the Greek philosophers into Arabic. In turn, these works were studied by the Arab-speaking Jews of North Africa and Spain and translated into Hebrew. The Black Jews of the Moorish Kingdom of Spain translated these works into the Latin language, and from Spain, the sciences of the Greeks and the Afro-Asian people were transmitted to Western Europe. Erudite Moorish men made spectacular contributions to philosophy, medicine, mathematics, chemistry, astronomy, and botany. The Muslim doctors were no sawbones, but masters of their science. They established academies and universities for the rich. Also, there were many free schools. There were excellent libraries. The scholarly Caliph of Cordova in the 10th century sent all over the world for books. The library of this Caliph contained over 400,000 volumes. Moorish normal life was based on agriculture, manufacturing, and trade. The Moors brought into Spain rice, cotton, peaches, oranges, and lemons. Silk culture was introduced into Spain by the Moors. The Moors had fine pottery, glazed tiles, silk, velvet, brocades, jewels, and ornamental leather products. Moorish civilization had a gigantic effect on Portugal and Spain. This is the reason that these two countries were the first European powers to emerge after the Dark Ages. In the process of time, the Moors were driven southward. In the 11th century, El Cid conquered the great Moorish city of Valencia. Much later, in the 13th century, the king of Castile conquered Sevilla and Cordova. Afterward, the Moors were pushed into a small region called Granada. Outstanding Black Jews. Some of the outstanding Black Jews of Portugal, Spain, and North Africa were the following: Hasdai Ibn Shaprut, who lived between 925-975. He began his career as a physician and continued his interest in the medical profession, especially in drugs. Eventually, he became physician to the Caliph. Later, he rendered official advice concerning diplomatic matters. He remained in the center of Hebrew scholars whom he supported. He entertained Moses ben Hanak, a representative of the Babylonian academics who began the foundation of Talmudic learning in Spain. Saadia Gaon was born in 892 in the district of Fayum, Upper Egypt. He was learned in the Bible and the Talmud in Arabic as in Hebrew literature, in Greek and Arab philosophy. He was one of the first Hebrew grammarians and philosophic commentators of the Bible. Saadia composed special works on many subjects such as philosophy, astronomy, geography, theology, mathematics, music, poetry, chronology, and philology. Isaac of Fez, Morocco, or Al-Fasi, so named because he came from the city of Fez, lived during the 11th century, although the first important academy was founded by Moses ben Hanak in Cordova. The real foundation of Spanish Talmudic tradition was laid by Al-Fasi. The interest of Al-Fasi was in Talmudic law, especially such as were vital for the Hebrews of the dispersion. Samuel ibn Nagesh de la lived from 993 to 1056 or 1056. He started out as a grocer. His acquisition of knowledge in the languages, mathematics, and philosophy was extraordinary. Because Samuel had a beautiful handwriting, he was appointed secretary of the Grand Vizier. In this position, he was able to put to good use his wisdom and knowledge. When the vizier died, Samuel succeeded him as advisor to the Moorish king of Granada. On several occasions, he was appointed as the head of the Moorish armies of Granada. Samuel ibn Nagdela was respected also in Jewish circles. The king of Granada elevated him to the position of Nagib, that is, prince or leader of the Jews. Moses Maimonides was the outstanding black Jew during the Middle Ages. He is known as Rambam, Rabbeinu Moshe ben Maimon. Moses was born in Cordova on March 30th, 1135, the eve of the Passover. His father, Maimon, was an offspring of a great family of scholars and religious leaders. His family tree has been traced to Rabbi Judah the Prince, the composer of the Mishma, to the royal house of David. While the Talmud and rabbinics were the chief subject of Maimonides, he dedicated time to the sciences that were taught and postulated by the ancient Greeks and medieval Arabs. He received his learning under Hebrew and Moorish teachers, and before long he was learned in the natural sciences, mathematics, medicine, metaphysics, philosophy, and logic. In the year 1145, when Moses was 10 years of age, Abdullah ibn Tumart, a religious fanatic, founded the dynasty of the Almohades. The Almohades, who proclaimed a religion of absolute monotheism, succeeded after many battles in expelling the Almoravides, black Moors from the highland of Morocco, and established their own rule over the Moorish Empire. The Almohades directed a reign of terror and persecution not only against Judaism and Christianity, but also against sectarianism in Islam. The Almohades displayed their intolerance for other religions. There were prohibitions against the existence of churches and synagogues. Jews and Christians were given the one alternative, Islam or death. Abdul Mumen, who succeeded Abdullah ibn Tumart, permitted heretics to depart from his country, the Christian exiles from asylum in northern Spain. It was difficult for the Jews to find a place of security, and many of them died by the sword as martyrs for their religion. Some of the Jews converted to Islam as a disguise and remained loyal to their own faith, practicing Judaism in secret. About the middle of the 12th century, when Maimonides was 13 years of age, the Almohades crossed the Mediterranean into Spain and established their power in the Andalusia. In the late spring of that year, the Almohades invaded the city of Cordova and instituted a reign of terror and persecution. The magnificent synagogues were destroyed, the Talmudic schools at Seville and Lucena were closed, and non-believers in Islam, Jews and Christians, were given the alternatives of Islam, expulsion, or death.
Because of all the turmoil and social unrest, the family of Moses Maimonides decided to depart from the inhospitable land and to sail across the Mediterranean to Morocco in northern Africa. They remained in the city of Fez for about 5 years and then traveled to Palestine because the environment was not conducive to learning. Moses moved to Egypt. Moses Maimonides continued his study in medicine. His fame as a physician now spread throughout Egypt and beyond. It is said that Moses was offered a position as a physician to King Richard, the Lionhearted, leader of the Third Crusade. When Moses was about 50 years of age, he was appointed by Al-Fadhil, the vizier of Egypt, as his own medical advisor, and he was given a place among the royal physicians. Moses was also a great leader and judge of the Egyptian Jewish community. His son followed in his footsteps religiously and secularly, receiving the leadership of the Jewish communities and as a physician to the Sultan. Other outstanding black Jews of Spain were poets such as Salomon ibn Gabirol, Moses ibn Ezra, and Judah HaLevi. The expulsion of the Jews from Spain and Portugal. It was AD 1492, January 2nd, when the Moorish stronghold of Granada surrendered to the armies of King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella. For the first time since the year 711, all of Spain was in Christian hands. The decree to expel the Jews from Spain was signed on March 31st in one of the corridors of the Great Alhambra, the palace of the Moorish kings of Granada. The reason given for the expulsion of the Jews was that it was thought they corrupted the Marranos, Jews converted to Christianity, by privately encouraging them in disloyalty to Christianity. The ultimatum given to the Jews expired August 1st, 1492, but the last group of Jews did not leave until August 2nd, 1492. This date is of strange coincidence. That day was the 9th of Ab, the fast day, which is reminiscent of the destruction of the first and second temples. Professor Alan H. Godby says that the reign of the last Jewish king of Ghana terminated in 1492. In order to satisfy Queen Isabella of Spain, King Manuel of Portugal promulgated a royal decree expelling the Jews and Moors from his country in 1496. The Jews who were expelled from Spain and Portugal were scattered throughout the Mediterranean coast. It is estimated that over 100,000 Jews departed from Spain and Portugal during the persecutions and the expulsions. Some of these Jews went to Northern Europe, Italy, and Turkey, but most of them went to Muslim countries of Northern and Western Africa. These black Jews would naturally go to African countries, most of all, because of less persecution, and they could disguise themselves easily among blacks. R.H.M. Elwes gives a graphic description of the Portuguese Jew Baruch Spinoza, middle-sized, good features, skin somewhat black, black curly hair, long eyebrows of the same color, so that one might know by his looks that he was a descendant from Portuguese Jews. When the Jews were expelled from Spain, about 100,000 entered Portugal. They were permitted to enter under the condition that they pay the poll tax, with the understanding that they would leave the country within 8 months. Also, at this time, the king obligated himself to take the Jews wherever they desired at the termination of the 8 months. When the time expired, many Jews were stranded because the king did not provide enough ships in time. All the black Jews who were left behind were deprived of their freedom and sold into slavery. During the reign of King João II or John II, 700 black Hebrew children were ruthlessly taken away from their parents in Portugal and transported to the island of Tomi, off the west coast of Africa. This island is located near Nigeria, Cameroon, and Gabon. Alan H. Godbey says that the Portuguese founded the island of San Thome in 1471. In the year 1481, King John II of Portugal, who reigned from 1481 to 1495, offered the Jews of his kingdom the choice of baptism or settling at Saint-Thome. Multitudes of Jews were sent to this island during the reign of King John II. These Jews, Judeos, Judios, as the Portuguese call them, are serious, reserved, and wealthy, holding most of the trade in their hands. The Portuguese were the first Europeans to establish themselves on the West African coast. They came first as merchants and secondly as conquerors and slavers. Later in this work, the black Jews in the Portuguese possessions in West Africa will be discussed in greater detail. Now, let us return to the Jews of North Africa. With the influx of tens of thousands of black Jews from Spain and Portugal seeking refuge in African ports, Morocco received a great share. But before this date, many Jewish tribes were entrenched in Fez, the Atlas, and the desert. In Morocco, there was a revival of Moorish and Jewish science in all areas. The Hebrew Academy in Fez competed with the one in Kairouan, Algeria. There were many debates and lectures between the sages and scholars of these schools. Eldad the Danite, a Hebrew from the Jewish kingdom of Ghana, visited these schools in the 9th century. There was a celebrated Hebrew colleague at Sahilmasa in the desert south of Fez. The school of Sahilmasa produced many illustrious scholars. There were grammarians, masters of Talmudic law, poets, and philologists. This period of Jewish scholarship came to an end when the fanatical Almohades, Unitarians went on the war path in 1145 and destroyed the city of Sahilmasa. This reign of terror was carried out against all non-Muslims. Concerning the destruction of Sahilmasa, Ibn Isra writes, I say, quote, there be mourning for the community of Sahilmasa, city of great scholars and sages. She sees her light covered with shadows. The pillars of the Talmuds were shattered. The temples of law was destroyed and the Mishnah was trodden underfoot. There are many Jewish tribes and settlements throughout Morocco and the Sahara Desert. The Ayat Moussa or Beni Moussa, son of Moses, is one of the spectacular Jewish tribes. Leo Africanus, a Moorish converted Jew, states that the Jews of North Africa are of a hybrid quality. They have proselytized and intermarried among the Greeks, Vandals, Romans, Spaniards, and Portuguese. The Jews intermarried among the Greeks when the latter established their colony in Libya called Cyrenaica. Some intermarriages occurred between Jews, Romans, and Vandals when the latter two invaded North Africa. And before the Jews were expelled from Spain and Portugal, there were some intermarriages. Considering all this intermingling, many Jews of North Africa still retain much of their colored features. According to Maurice Fishberg, who was quoted by Alan Godbey, he was unable to distinguish a Jew from a Mohammedan while passing along the streets of Algiers, Constantine, a city of northern Africa, and Tunis. It is remarkable that among the non-Jewish natives, there are seen many Jews of Negro type. Fishberg visited Africa during the early part of the 20th century. There are black Jews living in the multitudes of oases in the Sahara Desert. Nahum Slochize, the white Jewish Rebbe, visited these Jews of North Africa and the Sahara during the turn of the century. Slochize obtained his information of these Jews from three sources. One, from the historical records of the Arabs. Two, from the oral traditions of the inhabitants of the Sahara. Three, from archaeological evidence excavated from the ruins of old Jewish cities in the Sahara and Sudan, which date from the 13th century. About halfway down the eastern border of Algeria, there are large settlements of black Jews at a place called Ouargla, says Slochizu. Jews were at Ouargla in as early as 620 AD, according to Godbe. Again, Godbe says, quote, in the Ouargla oasis of Algeria, 350 miles from the Mediterranean, is a colony of Jews as black as Negroes. In the Garian section of Libya, not too far from Ouargla, there exist the Troglodyte Jews. It is reported that the Jews fled to the strongholds of Nefausa mountain range because of Roman and Arab persecution. Godbe quotes H.S. Cowper, who says that the Jews of the city of Tripoli assert that they migrated from Garian. These Jews constructed subterranean synagogues and underground houses. Slochizu visited the strongholds of these Troglodyte Jews in the early part of the century. The Jews had built compartments 3 and 4 stories underground, containing a population of 30,000. Godbe says that Hesse Wartig visited their cities of Beni Abbas, Jebel Nefusa, Yehud Abbas, Tigrena, Jebel Ephren. They had shops, stores, schools, and synagogues all underground. The achievements of these Jews prove what a persecuted society can do under adverse conditions. These Jews had a foundation to build on. Unlike other persecuted people, they had their history, culture, laws, language, and skills. Between Ouargla and the Garian, there is a Jewish town called Tigrena. Here, the Jews have also constructed subterranean compartments. Nahum Slochizu says he was guided to an ancient synagogue which was located underground. At this time, he had made an extensive observation of the village, which contained 20 underground courts and its 700 inhabitants. Also, he found there a young man teaching Hebrew. When Slochizu was in this city about 1 hour, the men had just returned from the market. Slochizu says they are all of fine dark type. The rabbi was descended from Jews who had immigrated from Morocco. The rabbi at this time informed Slochizu of the fact that there existed in the district many traces of deserted Jewish cities and cemeteries now abandoned. The Jews of this country have handed down the oral tradition that in ancient times they constituted the major of the population, but that epidemics, wars, and frequent conversions to Islamism have reduced their number. On one occasion, Slochizu met a Jewish itinerant merchant of Nefausa who had just arrived from Fezzan. This Jew had traveled all the routes of the Sahara. He assured Slochizu that other Jews existed at least in the East Sudan, Chad, Sudan, and Ethiopia, a black-skinned population which some call the Felici, and which are generally known among the Tuaregs as the Crit. They observe the Sabbath and are known to be of Jewish origin. Many of the tribes in the Sahara and in the Sudan are Muslims in religion, but are Hebrew in nationality. Nahum Slochizu says numbers of these Islamized Jews may be found everywhere. They are among the nomads of Algeria, the Smoul, the Hanasha, the Traras, the Masmata, the Maugherin, the Kabyles, the Taut. You will find them among the Yureshfana, the Garyani, the Brahmi in Tripoli. You will find them in southern Morocco among the powerful clans of the Dagatuns, who control the routes of the Sudan and southward. They are not Jewish by religion, but aware of their Hebrew origin. They are friendly to Jewish merchants. Frequently, the Jews the Jew is the only communication between these tribes and the outside world. The Dagatun Jew are scattered in clans through many caravan routes, oases of the Saharan and the Sudan. Godbe says the word Dagatun means traders. They are located near Timbuktu and hundreds of miles northward. They are also found east of Timbuktu and Gao. The two main factors that motivated the Black Jews to penetrate into North Africa were commerce and persecution. Also, these two factors impelled them to migrate into Central Africa, which is known as the Sudan. The West African Jews during the slave trade. The Black Jews who migrated to the Sudan from the north converged with the Jews migrating from the Eastern Sudan to the countries of the Niger River. It is a known fact that the Jews and Judaism were in Africa 1500 years before Islam, and that everywhere the Arabs went, the Jews were there. The Black Jews guided the Arabs and Moors into Spain and acted as interpreters. When the Muslims came into the Sahara, they found the Black Jews stationed on all the trade routes. And I can positively say that where Mohammedanism is currently prevailing in the Sudan, Judaism once had been dominant. There is much proof and still much more to be revealed by scholars that there existed prior to the slave trade and subsequent to it many Jewish tribes, colonies, and kingdoms in West Africa. The Moorish writer Leo Africanus informs us of the past existence of a medieval Hebrew state called Kamnuria or Kanuria. Its two main cities were Kamnuri, obviously its capital, and Nagira, and this state was located north of the Senegal River. According to this Moorish Jew, this Black African Hebrew state had vanished by his time. There are two reasons given for the ruin of this kingdom. One, the intensive sandstorms of the Sahara Desert caused droughts and rendered the cities uninhabitable. Two, the migration of the Fulas or Fulbe towards the west. The Kanuri called the Fulas Filata. These Fulas transmigrated the entire Sudan from the Nile to Senegal. The Kanuri Jews are now located in the central Sudan along trails hundreds of miles north, south, east, and west of Lake Chad, where they migrated from Senegal. It is the conclusion of some scholars that when the Jewish kingdom of Ghana fell, many of the Hebrew tribes established settlements among the African tribes throughout Central and Western Africa. Thus, the Moorish writer El-Edresi and Andalusia, Spain, wrote in the early part of the 12th century about the powerful Hebrew colony of Lamlam. Lamlam was situated about 200 miles west of Timbuktu. The Hebrew merchants were then monopolizing the trade that was concentrated at Timbuktu. Lamlam was entirely Jewish and she fought wars to maintain her control of trade. Edrisi also said that there were only two towns south of the Kingdom of Ghana and continues. According to what the people of this country report, the inhabitants are Jews. When they had reached the age of puberty, they were branded on the countenance of at least on the temple with fire, leaving identifying marks. All the dwellings in their countries were built on the bank of a river which followed into the Nile. Idrisi meant the Niger River. It was the belief of the time that the Niger formed an upper reach of the Nile. The Black African Hebrews had settlements not only in the interior of Africa, but they also had communities on the west coast of Africa from Morocco to Angola. In the year 1856, Dr. J.L. Wilson wrote his History of Western Africa. He transmits to us the composite religious culture of some of the inhabitants of Senegambia, or Senegal. The Guinea in synagogue, he said, there is a complete medley of paganism, Judaism, and Mohammedanism, and it is difficult to say which of the three occupies the most prominent place or exerts the greatest influence upon the character of the people. However, the sentiment of the inhabitants regarding this multi-religious mixture was that the combination of the three religions furthered the welfare of all. How do we rationalize and explain the medley of paganism, Judaism, and Mohammedanism near the ruins of the medieval Jewish kingdom of Kamnuria? It is obvious to researchers that after the breakup of the Hebrew kingdoms of Ghana, Kamnuria, and Lamlam, the black Jews migrated to remote regions of the interior and the coast. Then these Hebrews came under the pressure of Muslim propaganda and pagan influence, resulting in what is known as cultural diffusion. If you recall what Sloches said, many Jews became Muslims but still retained their Jewish origins. Wilson also informs us that in northern Guinea, there is a conglomeration of Judaism and paganism combined, and in Wilson also informs us that in northern Guinea, there is a conglomeration of Judaism and paganism combined, and in southern Guinea, there is a combination of Judaism, paganism, and some traces of Christianity. In northern Guinea, of Portuguese Guinea, Judaism is more highly practiced. Some of the outstanding rites are purifications, the observance of the new moons, a designated period of the weeping for the dead, during which time they wear sackcloths and ashes, bloody animal sacrifices with the careful sprinkling of blood upon the doorpost and the altars, the divisions of the tribes into different families, frequently into 12 parts, the 12 tribes of Israel, formal processions, circumcision, and various other practices, probably of Hebrew derivation. A few of these rituals, especially circumcision, might have been derived from the Muslims, but we are forced to consider the entire congeries of the Hebrew cultural traits, which is indicative of Hebrew religion. Wilson says, although the natives of Africa retained these outward rites and ceremonies with the utmost tenacity, they have little or no knowledge of their own origin or the particular object which they are intended to commemorate. Many of them are performed to shield themselves from some threatened evil or to secure some coveted good. But in the great majority of the cases, they are attended merely as a matter of habit. And the only reason assigned for observing them is that their ancestors did the same before them. It stands to good reason that if their ancestors observed these Hebrew rites, they were surely Hebrews. It is written, they have said, "Come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in their remembrance." Like the black Jews in America, some of the Jews of Guinea don't remember their original nationality. This deplorable ignorance is attributed to various causes. 1, the fall of the Hebrew kingdoms. 2, the lack of communication with Jewish educational centers. 3, intense persecution and the deliberate blotting out of the mind their true nationality. Thus, Nahum Sloches said this about the Islamized Jews he met. In most cases, these Hebrews by race and Muslim by faith seek to hide their origin, which has become a burden to them. In another example, the persecution of the black Jews in Portugal was so ruthless and frequent that Cecil Roth tells us the Jews did not divulge to their children the secret of their religion until they had attained the age of reason. The Hebrew religion is such that if you deny your religion, you will eventually deny your nationality. The sociologists and psychologists know, and history has proven that. If you deny your culture and nationality over a long period of time, you will totally forget it through a process of assimilation. The black Jews came to Africa not only by land, but also by sea. As you recall, In the year 1484, King John of Portugal deported great numbers of black Jews to the African island of Saint-Thome. The island of Saint-Thome near Nigeria and Cameroon was discovered by the Portuguese in 1471, and it was established as a penal colony. To this island, Jews were sent who would not accept baptism. It is obvious that the Jews were deported to Saint-Thome not only to mete out punishments to them, but King John's ulterior motive was to establish a commercial base with sophisticated black Jews in his growing empire in Africa. As time elapsed, the black Jews in Portugal and the black Jews in the Portuguese colonial possessions became known as the Black Portuguese. They were called Black Portuguese because they were born in Portugal and they knew the history, culture, and language of Portugal. As it has been mentioned before, King John of Portugal furnished ships in order to deport the Jews to any country they desired. However, unscrupulous Portuguese captains exacted as much money as they could from the Jews and dumped their human cargo at various places along the West African coast. As a result, Alan Godbey writes that when Wood Raid met blacks in Guinea, West Africa, who called themselves Portuguese and claimed descent from Portugal. Reade wrote his book in 1864. In another case, Daniel P. Mannix writes us that Captain Cutler, a slave trader from Boston, was barbarously murdered with two of his sailors by a community of black Portuguese established near the mouth of the Sierra Leone River. The Portuguese were the first Europeans to trade on the West African coast and to establish colonies on a large scale. The Canary Islands were discovered by the Portuguese in 1341, ceded to Spain by Papal Bull in 1344. Senegal was discovered by the Portuguese in the 15th century, and the first settlements are believed to have been black Portuguese. The Gambia River mouth was discovered by the Portuguese in the 15th century. Sierra Leone first visited by the Portuguese in 1462. Guinea, discovered by Portuguese in 1446, the island of Saint-Thome, discovered by Portuguese in 1471. The new inhabitants were black Jews deported here in 1484. Black Jews migrated to Angola coast from Saint-Thome between 1482 and 1499. The white Portuguese missionaries reached Angola by 1560, but white settlers did not establish a community until 1575. Let us return now to the Jews of Saint-Thome Island. Scholars are uncertain concerning the exact number of Jews deported to this island. It is certain that the number lies in the thousands, perhaps the tens of thousands. Continuous research is needed in African history. In African Hebrew history, especially in the excavation of ruined Hebrew cities of Africa. When this gigantic work is completed, I believe the evidence will reveal information that will amaze humanity. It is my sincere belief that a greater number of black Jews were deported to the western coast of Africa than is admitted by some writers. By the edict of King Manuel of Portugal in 1496, banishing the Jews from Portugal. All Jews were to be out of Portugal by October 1497. However, considering this matter, he decided to Christianize the Jews, fearing the loss of a valuable population. He wanted the continued use of their knowledge and services. He concluded that the only way the Jews could be tolerated in his country was to force them into the Christian faith. In March 1497, a command was proclaimed throughout Portugal for all Hebrew children between 4 and 14 years of age to be brought for baptism. All parents who did not bring their children voluntarily had their children taken away violently by the officials and forced into baptism. Cecil Roth writes, "Scenes of indescribable horror were witnessed as they were torn away by the royal bailiffs. The latter did not obey their instructions too closely, frequently seizing young people of both sexes up to the age of 20. In many cases, parents smothered their offspring in their farewell embrace. In others, they threw them into wells in order to save them from the disgrace of apostasy and then kill themselves. Sometimes even old men were dragged to the churches and forcibly baptized by overzealous fanatics. Horrendous conditions like these and much worse compelled many Jews to escape secretly out of this country. These black Jews went to Portuguese colonial possessions in Western Africa. Remember that the Portuguese colonies in Western Africa were Guinea, Saint-Thom Island, Senegal, Angola, and a few islands near the African coast. During the persecutions in Portugal, thousands of Jews left the country. The Jews were leaving the country in such large numbers that in 1499 and 1531, the king published a decree forbidding the new Christians, black Jews, from leaving Portugal without special permits. At this time, many Jews became Christians out of fear. Many of them were known as secret Jews, practicing Judaism in secret under the guise of Christianity. Some writers call these Jews nominal Christians, Jews who are Christians in name only, but practice Judaism in secret. In spite of all the prejudices against the black Jews of Portugal, they excelled in all the trades, skills, professions, and businesses. The wealth of the Jews was tremendous. Portugal is a small country about the size of the state of Florida. Nevertheless, in the year 1610, the Jews alone were worth 80 million ducats. The Jews dominated commerce and the export of trade, so naturally the black Jew would engage in commerce and trade in many parts of Africa after they had fled from Portugal.
The black Jews of Angola. In the country called the Gabon near the Congo, there were black Jews known as the Bavumbu. Some writers call them by various names, such as Mavambo, Mayamba, Mayumba, and Mavumbu. Abbe Proyart, a French writer, says that these Jews held the coast of Luango between the Congo River and Rio Muni in Gabon. In 1776, their country began about 60 miles from the coast and extended north from the Congo about 200 miles. In appearance, these black Jews are hardly distinguishable from the other Africans. It has been reported that these Jews practice some divination and magic like native Africans. However, they observe some Jewish ceremonies and live in separate communities, not considering themselves native Africans. The villages of these Jews are situated along the Luango coast for more than 100 miles, even south of the Congo River. Godbey writes that when they are interrogated in regard to their origin, some of these Jews said they migrated from the south, probably Angola, some from the north, probably Nigeria, some from the other side of the mountains, perhaps Ethiopia. Like the Portuguese Jews, the Bavumbu Jews were very active in commerce. When David Livingston was in Africa, he discovered a settlement of educated blacks about the year 1847. They were located inland about 200 miles from the Luanda coast and are known as the Jews of Angola. These black Jews were active in commerce, eager to learn, and possessed much knowledge of Portuguese history and law. In their commercial enterprises, these Jews penetrated inland hundreds of miles from the coast and were known also as clerks and writers. Livingston considered these Jews to be deportees from Portugal. St. Paul de Luanda began, like Saint-Thome, as a penal colony for the punishment of criminals. In Portugal, many of these black Jews were considered criminals. Also, many of these black Jews of the land of Angola, it is said, came from Saint-Thome Island. All available evidence indicates that the Jews of the Angola coast were Portuguese Jewish outcasts. Many black Jews were established inland and along the coast of Angola, the Congo, and Gabon. Frederick Ratzel writes that the tribes on the Luanga coast and the Cabinda north of the Congo River were once Christianized. Ratzel observed a ceremony of baptism followed by circumcision. However, these tribes were Jewish in origin, The Christianity Ratzel saw among them was a disguise. The circumcision practiced among them is of Jewish derivation. The Christians in Portugal did not practice circumcision. In fact, Cecil Roth wrote that circumcision among Jews in Portugal was practically an impossibility, for its discovery was equal to a death sentence. Godbey wrote concerning the Mavumbu Jews on the Luangwa coast. It seems that the Mavumbu may be the remnant of a much more numerous Judaism that was vigorously assailed by Portuguese missionaries. The Abbe Proyart records that nominal Christians, secret Jews, once numbered hundreds of thousands. Whenever the Jews were in Spain, Portugal, or their colonial possessions, they disguised themselves as Christians in outward form, but practiced Judaism in secret. Many of these new Christians knew Christian rites better than the old white Christians. In the year 1547, the papal office authorized the establishment of the system of the Inquisition in Portugal. The word Inquisition means inquiry or investigation. The Inquisition consisted of a tribunal of religious judges. Its purpose was to investigate and purge out heretical Christians, persons who questioned certain Christian principles. Although some white Portuguese Christians suffered at the hand of the Inquisition, this system was mainly directed against the new Christians, the secret black Jews. The Inquisitions were persistent, gruesome, and ruthless in the totality of their procedures. They interfered in the private affairs of individuals. They intimidated and coerced individuals to inform on their neighbors. They employed a wide variety of continuous, horrendous tortures, including public shows of burning human beings at the stake. And in order to satisfy their desires for the punishment of heretics, they sought out not only the living, but also the dead. Garcia de Horta, a Jew of Portugal, was discovered to have been a secret Jew. His body was dug up out of his grave and burned by the Inquisition. In another case, a Jewish woman by the name of Elvira del Campo was indicted and tortured for 2 years in order to elicit a confession from her. The charges against her were not eating pork and putting on clean linen on Saturdays. According to this woman, these charges were not heretical practices. She wanted to be clean and pork made her sick. Whenever the Christian Jews could escape from Spain and Portugal beyond the reach of the Inquisition, they threw off the disguise of Christianity and practiced Judaism openly, as they did in Turkey. However, the unfortunate new Christians, nominal Christians or secret Jews in Portuguese possessions in Western Africa, India, and elsewhere could not throw off the disguise of Christianity. The Inquisition even dispatched its inquisitorial agents to the Canary Islands, Madeira, Guinea, India, South America, São Tomé, and Angola, in order to search out secret Jews. From 1561 to 1623, about 3,800 individuals were tried. Many of them were Christian Jews of São Tomé Island. They were charged with maintaining Jewish principles. Cecil Roth wrote that Christian Jews immigrated to the Portuguese colony of Angola in West Africa, where agents of the Inquisition were sent to hunt them out in 1626. Now we can understand why writers like Frederick Ratzel considered the tribes along the Luangwa and Cabinda coast Christians. These Jews had to maintain a Christian guise, and particularly so in the presence of white people. Any European could have been an agent of the Inquisition. It is certain that many black Jews of Portugal, São Tomé, and Angola, who became victims of the Inquisition and Portuguese persecution, were sold in the slave trade. This Atlantic Ethiopic slave trade lasted more than 400 years, from 1444 to about 1880, in some parts of South America. Some scholars have located the black Jews within the entire Niger River bend. The countries in this territory that have contained black African Jews include the following: Upper Volta, Ivory Coast, Ghana, Togo, Dahomey, and Nigeria. Joseph Dupuis, concerning the Jews in 1824, says, the lands occupied by these people cover a wide extent between Massina and Kabi. Massina is located in southern Mali, inside the Niger River bend, and Kabi is found in the southern part of the Ivory Coast. The Jews among the Ashantis. Among the Ashantis of the Gold Coast, Ghana, are found Jews who observe many Hebrew customs. They don't fight on Saturday, but they rest. They celebrate the New Year of the Jews, which occur in September or early October. They use the word Amen at the end of their hymn of Thanksgiving. Like the Hebrews of old, they marry in their tribe only. They perform cross-cousin marriages. The Ashanti Jews also observe the laws of uncleanness. After childbirth purification ceremony of the 40th day, the menstrual seclusion law, and ceremonial ablutions. The Ashanti Jews have a breastplate like the high priest in ancient Israel, and is divided into 12 parts representing the 12 tribes of Israel. Also, they have the misnephet or headdress with its gold disc in front, which in ancient Israel bore an inscription, "Holy to the Lord." The Black Jews of Dahomey. Dr. J. Cripple reported in 1926 that there existed a large Hebrew community of Black Jews in the interior of Dahomey, West Africa. These Hebrews have their own central temple where they sacrifice animals. In their temple are found many laws engraved on tablets which are attached to the temple walls. They have a high priest with a large number of priestly families whose members walk from house to house rendering educational and religious instructions to each family of the community. Moreover, these Jews have their own Kumash, the five books of Moses, written on old parchment in Hebrew letters, but they have no other books. What little Judaism they possess was transmitted to them from their ancestors. Dr. Kreppel says that they observe the Sabbath and other Jewish customs, despite the pressure from their pagan environment. Yoruba Jews of Nigeria. There are Black Jews in southern Nigeria who are called the Emoyo Kuen, or strange people, by the native Africans. But these Black Jews call themselves by the Hebrew name of Benai Ephraim, or sons of Ephraim. These Jews claim that their ancestors immigrated from Morocco, a fact which Godbey says is supported by their language, a mixture of Maghrebi Arabic and local Negro speech. Thus, Abu, father, has become Yaba. Mother, Hebrew M is Emma. Nevertheless, most of their language is similar to the Black Yorubas around them. The Yorubas have influenced these Jews to a great extent in their external social life. It is said that the crocodile is the sacred animal for all the customary sacrifices of the Yorubas appear to be the same for the Jews. The assertion of these Yoruba Jews is that their ancestors were driven from locality to locality by Muslim persecution. They did not find rest even when they arrived at Timbuktu. Surely the prophecy has been fulfilled, and among these nations shall thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest, but the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind. These Yoruba Jews lived in the Ondo district when Godbey wrote in 1930. This district is 900 miles southeast of Timbuktu. When Godbey wrote, they numbered about 2,000 people in 20 small hamlets. Pertaining to their Hebrew political structure and culture, they have seven hereditary heads of the community. Their leadership is that of a priesthood. They are known to have copies of portions of the Torah, Old Testament, preserved in a most holy place. However, their social life is not Torah controlled. Like many of the Hebrew cultural traits among the Ashanti Jews, these Black Jews observe certain Jewish customs among which are the great holy days. In almost every way, these black Jews are like the Yorubas and are hardly distinguishable from them, except for some outstanding Hebrew observances. One of the most notable among these black Jews was a young man named Bata Kindai Amgoza Ibn Lo Bagula, who was taken from Wayada Dahomey to Scotland. After he had received 4 years of the white man's education, he returned to his home in Africa. Dr. Alan H. Godby postulates the position that black Jews were on the West African coast from Senegal to Angola, and they, the Jews, were driven to this area from the Central Sudan by Muslim propagandism. Having a knowledge of the black Jews in the United States, Dr. Godby arrived at this conclusion. These facts have peculiar significance when the presence of Judaism among American Negroes is to be considered. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were brought to America from this Western Africa during the days of the traffic, beginning nearly 400 years ago. How much more of Judaism survived among West African Negroes in that earlier time? Question: as persecuted communities, they were rather more in danger than other Negroes of being raided by war parties and sold as slaves. It may be considered certain that many partially Judaized Negroes were among the slaves brought to America. How many of them might still hold some Jewish customs? Here is another question. Before Dr. Godby published his book, The Lost Tribes, A Myth, Rabbi Matthew organized a Hebrew congregation in 1918 and proclaimed that the black people of the United States and the West Indies are the original black Hebrews. There are hundreds of thousands of black African Hebrews scattered throughout the United States, not only in the urban areas but also in the rural communities of this nation. With the revelation of ample historical evidence, the authenticity of these black Hebrews can no longer be questioned. However, in regard to the purity of their Judaism among some of these Jews, that is another issue. Conclusion: according to biblical prophecy, the black Hebrews were supposed to have gone into slavery and captivity. Thus, we read of the prophet Jeremiah saying, "Judah has gone into captivity because of affliction and because of great servitude. She dwelleth among the heathen, she findeth no rest, all her persecutors overtook her between the straits." Prophecy is similar to history in one respect, that is, it repeats itself. Duality in prophecy has been recognized by many scholars. As the historical evidences indicate, the black Hebrews were snatched from the west coast of Africa and sold into captivity. Jeremiah again says, "For lo, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, saith the Lord, and I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it. For it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will break his yoke from off thy neck, and will burst thy bonds, and strangers shall no more make him serve, but they, the Hebrews, shall serve the Lord their God, and David their king, whom I will raise up to them. Therefore, fear thou not, O my servant Jacob, saith the Lord, neither be dismayed, O Israel, for lo, I will save thee from afar, and thy seed from the land of their captivity, and Jacob shall return, and shall be at rest and tranquil, and none shall make him afraid, for I am with thee, saith the Lord, to save thee. Though I make a full end of all nations whither I have scattered thee, yet will I not make a full end of thee, but I will correct thee in measure, and will not leave thee altogether unpunished." The Valley of Dry Bones, spoken of by the prophet Ezekiel, represents the nations that hold the black Hebrews under slavery and downpression, and the dry bones represent the black Hebrews, Ezekiel says. "So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood up upon their feet, an exceeding great army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried, and our hope is lost, we are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus saith the Lord God, behold, I will open your graves and cause you to come up out of your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. The prophet Ezekiel calls the country wherein the black Hebrews are downpressed graves. And ye shall know that I am the Lord when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up out of your graves, and shall put my spirit in you, and ye shall live, and I shall place you in your own land. Then shall ye know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, saith the Lord.